Hello and welcome to Office Mechanics. Coming up on the show, if you want to look at how we're actually protecting information when it's authored, stored, and shared, we're going to have a look at all the latest technologies for data loss prevention. And we'll even give an early look at the new incident management reports and auditing capabilities within data loss prevention. Joined again by Asaf Kashi. Welcome, Asaf.
Thank you, Jeremy.
So how do we think about information protection and data loss?
So as a rule, everywhere your data exists, moves, and is shared, we want to protect it. So we think about this in a couple of different ways. Let's take a look and get started. So here we have your company, the Microsoft Office 365 cloud, and a remote user. We split protecting your data into a couple of different areas. One, we think about protection of data at rest. This happens using BitLocker and other technologies such as some of our file encryption.
And we're also encrypting all of the different transfers using TLS or SSL between data centers, between end users, and between our customers and tenants' sites so that we make sure that all traffic is also encrypted, right?
That's right. We make sure that all the pipes are encrypted. Okay. So, beyond that, we think about DLP and data loss prevention, and this is something that we've had around for a while in messaging. We've had it in Exchange 2013, in Outlook, and in OAuth, and more recently we've announced and have started previewing the SharePoint Online and OneDrive functionality of DLP.
But this is just the service side. We're even going beyond that, right? We're going into even more areas to make sure the protection's even more pervasive.
That's right. We've recently announced that we're taking our policy tips, our user education and empowerment down to all of the Office clients. So we've had policy tips in Outlook 2013 and in OAuth. We've added it to Word, PowerPoint, and Excel, so the user is natively receiving those cues, those policy tips, their ability to override and interact with a policy in their productivity tool of choice.
All of this information is also sent up into our infrastructure as well, right?
That's right. So for the IT admin, we think of it in a couple of different ways. First, there's the policy management. So we have the Compliance Center, which, again, it's a recent announcement earlier this year, where you can manage the policies for all of the various workloads in one place. So you can apply one policy across your SharePoint, across OneDrive, across Exchange, et cetera. And in the future, there'll be more workloads there. Not only that, we're also taking all of those actions, all of those hits, the rule hits, the overrides that are coming back, and we're putting it in that one place and providing a really rich audit story that plays out for the IT admin, both in our reports and in our newly announced activity feeds.
So you're doing a lot in terms of making sure that the transparency of what's going on in your organization is also there through new auditing capabilities that we're going to demonstrate in a minute. Why don't we actually show a few of these demonstrations in terms of what we can do?
So what I have here, we're going to start with an email that I actually wrote up in my draft folder to you, Jeremy. And okay. I've attached a marketing survey data Excel file. And what you can see is pretty quickly the policy tip came up here. And let's see if we can zoom in a little bit here. You can see a policy tip on the screen that says, this message appears to contain sensitive information. The system has detected that. It flagged that it's the attachment. And it tells me that it may or may not comply with what my policy is for my business. So that means I, as an end user, can understand that while I'm authoring. I don't have to go read that 600-page handbook for my business. I don't have to interpret things. We're teaching the user right then and there. Let's take a look at the policy. We want to show how it's set up and built up. If I go here to our Compliance Center, and this is again one of those new areas, on the left side you can see that the Compliance Center has all of the archiving, device management, data loss prevention, anything that you think is compliancy. So anything the CISO or their IT department might be interested in, all in one place. If I take a look at data loss prevention, there are two items here. One, if I create a new policy, by default, all of the policies and regulations that you would need anywhere in the world are already built in. Now, is that going to be everything? Probably not. You're probably going to need to tune some things, but it's going to be the majority. So for most businesses, you don't have to start by being a super expert at all of these regulations. You can start using the stuff we have in the box.
And you don't start with a blank canvas. There are all these templated rules and actions that you can do based on these rules that we've got configured into the tool. You can start showing things like credit card information, social security numbers, also international equivalents of those things,
That's
all
right.
in the tool already. So making it really easy to get set up.
That's right. So Let's take a look at one of the ones that I've already configured. This one is the payment card industry, so PCI DSS. And you can see that this is built, the first page that comes up, you can see that there are locations here. We have SharePoint and OneDrive selected and all of the sites, so it's gonna apply to my entire tenant all with one click. I can always select and narrow it down, whether I'm testing it or applying it to one department or one group of sites. If I take a look at the rules that we've got configured, I've simplified these to just two rules. There's a low severity and a high severity. We're gonna open up the high severity and take a look at what it's looking for. So on my screen, you can see that I'm looking for any piece of content that has 10 or more credit cards. This is the high severity. We'll take one action for if catching 10 or more, and different action if we've got less than 10. Also, the other piece that's interesting, and this is a very common action or a very common condition for customers, is when content is shared external to my organization. Generally, data loss prevention or data leakage, we don't want to send this information outside my organization without thinking twice or sometimes three times about that.
Yep.
So let's see what actions we've got configured here. This is a new action, this first one up top. It says block access to content. So we did not want to be destructive about the content. If something is violating the policy, again, we want to make sure that the user can go and remedy it. Of course, that's assuming the IT organization wants to configure it that way. In this case, it'll restrict the sharing to just the site owner, the author of the document, and the last modifier. And again, you can select which one of them, but this allows you to have the right person remediate that as soon as they get notice of it. You don't have to say, great, let's delete the file or let's shut down the site or anything super destructive. Over time, we will add more and more actions. Encrypt is a very common one,
right,
as well as quarantine, delete, et cetera. So we will add all of the actions that we have in Exchange today over to the SharePoint site so it makes sense in that particular workload. Additionally,
great,
we
stuff.
have a notification here, and this one's going to be something we're going to look at more closely in a second. The notification configuration allows me to configure who gets notice of this violation, both on the back end, meaning IT, compliance, et cetera, as well as the end user. This is where you would configure that policy tip, the override ability, whether the user gets to participate or just be notified.
And you can customize the messages that they see as well if you want your own corporate customized verbiage in there, you can customize that tip.
That's right. It turns out that not only is it language sensitive, the tone of the message between different companies and different industries when you're trying to tell the user that they've violated a policy needs to be customized against the different regions of the world and the businesses that we are supporting. Finally, the last thing we're going to highlight here in the configuration side is the incident reports. Every rule hit can generate a GIR, generate incident report. This means that it is a real-time notification sent, in this case via email, to any mailbox or group that you would like, and it contains any metadata about this rule hit that you think would be relevant. So this is the way you would attach it to your ticketing system. This would be the way that you log it, again, in real time. Obviously, everything is also audited in a log that collects all an aggregate of all rule hits. All of this IT, I really want to go back to some IW. So let's kick that off and take a look at how the IW experiences all of this. We're going to start with my mailbox again, and I'm going to show a different message, and this one is the same attachment that I crafted before.
Okay.
This time I actually shared this earlier with you, Jeremy, using my OneDrive. So this attachment exists in my OneDrive. I right-clicked, I did share, a message got sent out.
What that means is, yeah, SharePoint's fired off a
real
message
simple.
To me to actually show that, and we can... Should we move over to my machine
yeah,
and show what that looks like?
Let's take a look at your machine.
All right, so on my computer, I have an Ignite folder from you. I've also got the message here, Ignite partner data.xlsx. That's the file itself that we actually applied protections against. And I know that because then SharePoint actually fired off another message saying that this item has been protected. I can open the blog, I can open the item and fix the issues, and I've got a link here to do that. A couple things that I'll see once I hit that site. Well, actually, first, before I hit the site, a couple things I'll see in the pop-up is that the item's shared with people outside my organization, so I can see exactly what's going on.
That's right. This is that policy tip experience. Same thing we saw in OA. We're seeing it over in SharePoint. It's very consistent. It's right in your productivity surface.
Right. So in my case, it's been shared with people outside my organization, as you had in your rule earlier. It also contains credit card information, so things that I don't want to have in that file. So I can either resolve that if I've got the ability to resolve that. There might be a false positive going on there. In this case, I'm going to close down, and I'll see that I also have access to the file. And if I want to look and see that policy tip again, if I, as I'm hitting the ellipses here on the right of the file name, I can see that there as well, and I can see the policy tip again if I'd like to. In my case, what I'm going to do is shut that down and actually show the experience inside of Excel, because this is really powerful now. I can actually use Excel in this case to view that DLP policy tip. Now, I'm going to say that I've got a couple of different messages. I've got software updates available, looks like.
Let's not update during the demo.
And I've got my policy tip here. This is the new one. I'll do a live zoom on that one just to show. This content may contain sensitive information. This is something brand new. Again, we had in the mail clients before, but this is in Excel here. We've also got it coming to PowerPoint and Word as well. And I'll look at the policy tip now. That will take me to the backstage of Excel and give me more information about the policy tip. Again, I've got a credit card number. It tells me that right from Excel's backstage exactly what's going on with that file. So really powerful in terms of not only when I'm receiving the file, but also as I'm authoring the file, I'll be able to see that right there within the app that I'm using, my favorite spreadsheet app, Excel in this case.
Everybody's favorite.
Yes.
Okay, so
let's go back to your machine and show even more.
Let's take a look. So one thing that we've said it before, incident management. This is something completely brand new. So we created the GIRs, we've had them in emails, we've talked to partners, some partners have connected the dots. We've also went ahead recently and built a solution pack that connects those GIRs, connect those incidents over to dynamic CRM. So what I'm going to show you is something we haven't really announced until this week, where what you can see is I'm in dynamic CRM, I have an active dashboard, and this is very similar to whatever ticketing system you're using. If you happen to use dynamic CRM, we have the solution pack for it. If you're using another ticketing system, we're working with our various partners to connect our DLP solution to that. In this case, I might be a frontline support engineer working on compliance cases, and you can see that there are a number of graphs showing untriaged cases. There's a queue of all the cases here. I can actually click on one, and let's take this one. It'll open this particular incident, and this incident is telling me I can do some research here. It's showing me there were 52 credit cards in this particular incident. There are one recipient, so it seems to be a lot of data, but only to one recipient. Maybe it's the wrong recipient. We can keep taking a look through this. We can see who sent this. Eric Gruber is the sender. So again, I can do the triage. I can assess how I want to react to this. What's the severity? If I scroll down, I can see what rules fired here in the middle of the screen. I can see some data, so I can see a snippet of the actual data. Again, all of this is configurable because sometimes you might want to triage the case without giving away the sensitive information all over again. Mm-hmm. So we don't want to propagate that. And then another really powerful thing that we've actually added using dynamic CRM here is at the bottom, I can actually see in this view all the incidents that relate to this particular user. So maybe these are a number of low-grade incidents, but I can see a trail that over time, the same person is doing the same thing. So I'm sure if I pulled your record here, we would see a lot of these low-grade ones.
Yeah, exactly. Wow.
So again, I can take an action. I can change the severity. I can say that I need to send a notification to the user or their manager and construct a workflow around this. And this is particular to every customer. Every customer has a ticketing system. Every customer uses it slightly differently. We're looking to integrate with all of them. Here's one way. And again, we're actively working with partners for this year to really connect it with other solutions.
So these are the auditing APIs that we're opening up for customization. Beyond all this, though, we have the ability to see some of this
data inside of our
Office 365 tenant directly.
That's right. So if I were to click in the Compliance Center on Reports, which I just did on my screen, the first link is this new auditing report that we've added around View Office 365 Activity Report. I've already opened the screen here, and you can see it's a very plain UI. The idea is most customers will actually export this data or use PowerShell or other APIs to suck that out, but you can do a quick search online. What I'm going to do here is actually browse for you, Jeremy. We're going to see what you've been up to lately. And what you guys are seeing here in real time is the fact that I've just narrowed it down to only Jeremy's actions, but I've taken all actions in all files. Again, I can scope it further or not. In this case, you can see that there are some password logon events, so security-based events. You can see that there's file fetched, file viewed, so all the interactions you have with the system. And when the details come up for each one of these, you can actually dive down into what client was he using, what IP address were you coming from. So again, you can do full-fledged security auditing, full-fledged compliance auditing right from here, or export this into your basically way to collate all of this and do some additional analysis.
There's a lot of things that we've shown here, but where is all of this going, Asaf?
Yeah, so as far as DLP for Microsoft, we're actually kind of expanding in two areas. One is breadth, so we definitely want to bring DLP into more and more both Microsoft, Office 365, Microsoft, and partner solutions. So we're expanding across. You see this over the last year and a half or so. Now, and we also look at depth, so adding more content. As we get feedback from our customers, what regulations are important, what technologies, as the market evolves, we're adding more depth into how we do DLP.
So lots of great advancements in terms of data loss prevention, in terms of information protection, all these things. You can follow those news items and more on the Office blog. We're also on the Trust Center, trust.office365.com. It's about all the time we have for today's show. Thank you for watching, and goodbye for now.
Thank you.